We've been in California now for, oh wow, a year and a half. I'm more than a year and a half.
Almost two in
Oh geez.
July.
Okay, so yeah, a while. And previously we were in New York, obviously New York City. What is it like there right now? Are you safe?
I live in Greenwich Village near Union Square Park. I am not going out of my immediate neighborhood and have not been out of my neighborhood in probably a month. The streets are pretty much empty except for a few people walking to do errands and walking their dogs. The construction projects have stopped because these are the ones in my neighborhood are non-essential construction. The stores and most of the restaurants have closed. Before the pandemic began, there were many empty storefronts because of the concatenation of problems, rising rents and competition from online commerce. So it's really pretty ghostly on the streets now. When I step outside at night to leave my garbage bag on the sidewalk for the sanitation workers to pick it up, I look around and there's nobody walking. So I live on a pretty quiet block, but I'm not used to seeing so few people on the streets. So it's bleak. It's bleak. It's really antithetical to New York culture.
Where we are, it's not suburban. What would you call it? Two-story single-family houses that are right against each other, that kind of density. And there's a house and there's a backyard. So it's much easier for us and people in these kinds of living conditions to stay inside, to do your yoga in the living room and whatever. And because you're used to living inside of a house and then in a car and then, Costco or a restaurant. But for a place like New York, it's New Yorkers, it must be much more, emotionally and like psychologically difficult because a huge part of your life is not inside. I mean, that's why you live in a city,
Our mobility is all about being in public space. Either we're walking or, there are far fewer people biking now, but, we're walking or biking or, of course, taking the subway or buses. When I see buses go by on the street now, I see that there might be one or two passengers in addition to the driver. The buses are empty. So, and I know that the ridership on the subway system is down from about 86,000 passengers a month to 4,000, which is
Wow.
financially disastrous for the subway, even though it might be better for people's health.
Is there a sense that, people there are taking it seriously? Because my feeling was that maybe the time is distorted now, but maybe a week or 2 weeks ago that a lot of people in New York weren't taking it seriously. And I don't know if that's a kind of New Yorker toughness attitude that was part of it as well. But it seems like now much more people in the city are, adhering to staying inside as much as possible.
Well, I think that taking the social distancing measures seriously depends on age and the leadership of local government officials. Mayor de Blasio delayed quite a bit in closing down the public school system and asking people seriously to stay at home. So that was, one very important set of cues that people did not get to stay away from other people. The playgrounds in public parks and basketball courts remained open long past the days when they should have been shut down because, kids and basketball players, people tend to cluster too close to each other in those kinds of recreational spaces. But I've also seen a lot of young people in photos and images online in Florida and California going to the beach. That's something, that's something we don't have here. We do have public parks and jogging trails and stuff, but we don't have the beach. Oh yeah, I guess we have Coney Island, but I haven't seen photos of people on Coney Island on the on the beach, and the weather here has been not really warm enough to luxuriate on the beach. So maybe we've been encouraged to stay indoors by lousy weather.
Yeah, I guess that's true. California, it's always good weather. It's tempting to go outside. But you had mentioned also that, interestingly, that, you know, a number of the storefronts and stores are closed now because of the pandemic. But a lot of them were on their way to being that or already closed up because of online retail, which is a very nice transition to the book that just came out, your book that just came out, The Innovation Complex, Cities, Tech, and the New Economy. I've read through it. And so first, I think what's interesting is that, if I remember correctly, when you started this research project, well, one question is, did you always know it was going to culminate in a book? And the other is that it seemed like the tech economy and that whole discussion wasn't necessarily the first thing that you sought out to investigate.
That's right. But you're right in asking about both those things. I didn't exactly know that this would be a book. I wanted to start a new research project in the fall of 2014. I had not quite launched a new project because I had just finished working with about a dozen other people around the world in creating a book about neighborhood shopping streets, actually, and how they reflect globalization and gentrification. So I was just starting to sniff around to see what a new research project might be. I thought I might look into what was happening in the creative economy in New York City, something that I have written about off and on for many years, ever since I wrote a book called Lost Living and started looking at artists in New York. So I started out by talking to some people in the creative economy, but very quickly I shifted to looking at digital technology and the uses of digital technology by emerging artists. And also looking very quickly from that to production, for-profit production for the creative economy. And I'll tell you exactly, I did an interview with a woman whom I knew, who was at that time in 2014, 2015, the president of BRIC, B-R-I-C, an umbrella institution for arts and culture in downtown Brooklyn. And while I was speaking with her, I realized that Doug Steiner, the founder of Steiner Studios, a premier movie and production space located at the Brooklyn Navy Yard, was a member of her board. So she introduced me to him, and I realized that there was a lot happening in creative industries in New York that I should investigate. At the same time, I started doing interviews at EDC, the New York City Economic Development Corporation, which is the somewhat obscure name for the city government's economic development agency. I started out looking at the media part of EDC and interviewing the founding director or first director of New York Media Lab, which is a partnership between several universities, notably New York University, the city government in the form of EDC, and a group of large media corporations headquartered in New York that make up one of the city's most important legacy industries. And I'm emphasizing the parts of that partnership because that clued me into the triple helix, as a researcher has called it, the triple partnerships, the tripartite partnerships between public sector, private sector, and nonprofit sector that are extremely important in supporting the tech infrastructure of cities, and particularly in New York. So there I was, you know, starting with creative artists and actually thinking that it would be interesting to document the differences in incomes and living conditions between creative artists being the poor and Google engineers being the rich. But I, you know, very quickly shifted from that to looking at the entire tech ecosystem in New York.
And so the triple helix, which is the public, the private public sector, private sector, and the nonprofit. Nonprofit would also include typically academic institutions, schools.
Exactly. Right. Exactly. Very important for tech because that's where you have a lot of computer scientists.
Right. So let me ask you that. Is it common for maybe for researchers in general, for use more specifically, to start a project that way and be that loose and open with it? I'm curious.
Well, that's my MO, but in principle, even sociologists are supposed to be scientific. They're supposed to start out with hypotheses that can be verified or not verified and modified accordingly. But I have never worked that way. Don't tell anybody, but all your listeners will have to keep this secret. I approach research projects as if they are jigsaw puzzles. And I usually start with a real life question, like what's going on here and how does this work? What is this box called tech ecosystem? And how did it move from Silicon Valley to New York City? And then I try to tease out all the different parts of the puzzle and fit them together. And in, you know, in a somewhat impressionistic, artistic way, I like to think, I get to a point where I say, okay, I understand the whole picture. I can form a whole picture, and this is the way it works.
It's interesting to me. I mean, I think there's something, I don't know, elegant, interesting about that kind of openness to kind of bounce around to see what the question actually is, you know, and not be too forceful with trying to answer only the one question that you want to ask, but letting yourself to kind of flow around.
Well, I have to be honest and say that there is an approach in sociology called grounded theory, where you are looser and you let your findings at every step inform your next steps. And, you know, I guess if I wanted to be formal about this, I'd say, yeah, I do grounded theory.
Okay, so I understand. Categorically, if you had to choose, that would be the thing.
Right. That's the box I would have to check. Or, you know, but if jigsaw puzzle were a box, I would check that.
Gotcha. And so this project started roughly in, what was the date, 2014?
In fall of 2014, I remember very distinctly because I actually wrote up a little proposal submitted it to the Advanced Research Collaborative at the CUNY Graduate Center where I teach. And I was able to get a free semester to start work on the project. So then, you know, once I had the free semester, I really had to do the work.
Right. It's good motivation.
Right.
So the book is organized, I think, in an interesting way, too. There's half a dozen chapters, maybe six to eight chapters, something like that. And you kind of start with, it goes in scale, it works in scale. So there's kind of the small increment, which is the hackathons, and then there are meetups, which are slightly larger in various ways. And then there are accelerators, and then there's talking about venture capitalist companies, and then all the way to entire districts. And of course, coming from a design, urban design architecture background, I'm like, oh, scale, I can relate to this idea.
Right, yes, that's the point. Thank you, that is the point.
Yes. So we want to hear a little bit about these different things. So a hackathon, what is a hackathon? Because it's a pretty unique and weird phenomenon in a way.
Sure. And I should say that I'm a bit old to go to a hackathon and blend in. So I was very happy to use the first year PhD student who was assigned to work with me at that point. That was like 2015 already. And he walked into my office the first day. He already has a master's degree, or had a master's degree, in cultural anthropology, and had done ethnographic research, where you go to a research site, spend a lot of time there, take meticulous notes, talk to people, and try to blend in, but really understand what the people in the situation are experiencing and thinking and going through. So he walked into my office and I said, "Oh, I'm so glad to meet you. You have a background in doing ethnography. I want you to go to hackathons." And this guy was at that point like 25 years old. And he said, "Great. What are hackathons?" So I did not feel so bad, because at least I knew already what hackathons were. The world can be divided between, you know, people who have heard of hackathons and people who have no idea what they are. So hackathons are competitions that last overnight. They often last through almost all of a weekend. Mostly young people participate. They could be college students or graduate students. They also can be people who are employed. But the crucial thing is that nearly all of them know how to write code, because the purpose of a hackathon is to have people both cooperate in teams and compete between the teams to write computer code to create or to improve an app or an API. The hackathons that we chose to follow were all sponsored by businesses. So there's a very strong, you know, company motivation to get people to compete for the sheer love of the game, you know, and the joy of writing code in a high pressure situation, to make products that these companies can then sell for their own profit. So as a sociologist, I chose a built-in situation where I knew I could be critical, because there were people participating from very different motivations, but there was a very clear set of expectations that spelled exploitation. So those are the hackathons we looked at. My research assistant, who became my co-author on a journal article about hackathons, he went to 7 hackathons during the course of the academic year and took, you know, terrific notes. We went over all of his notes, everything that was happening. I debriefed him after every hackathon. And he also did interviews, informal interviews, with hackathon participants while he was there. And both of us spoke to some hackathon participants after the hackathons. Mm. I also interviewed the professor from NYU, who was one of the people who introduced hackathons into New York City. He's a clinical professor of computer science at NYU and the co-founder of an organization called Hack New York. Mm-hmm. It was interesting to look back at the video that organization had a student make in 2010 when they were founded, to encourage college students from all over the metropolitan area to register to participate in the hackathon. And it was, you know, amazing, even 5 years later in 2015, to look at that video, which I discovered online, to look at it and to see this student say, "A hackathon, you know what that is? It's not really illegal, but maybe it could be illegal, because it is kind of like the hackers who were illegal back in the 1960s. And, you know, we still use the word hacking for illegally getting into certain, you know, computer systems and networks and websites that we should not get into. So he was saying, yeah, it's like that, but it's also going to be really cool. It's going to be awesome. Come, you know, come write code. So
is his hat like worn backwards?
Yeah, I guess. So, you know, but hackathons, it seemed to me, once I learned about them, it seemed to me that they were like the smallest space social space, geographical space, and also a time, by the way, because they're an event, where you can see the DNA of the tech ecosystem, even very tiny. You can see it in formation there. So I just want to go back to your point about scale and space. When I started this project and, you know, maybe till halfway through the research, I didn't know how I would frame the project in anything I wrote. I was thinking, well, I could talk about the different institutions, like here's the government, here's what the government does, and here's what companies do, and here's what these other people do, and here are these different actors, here are the venture capitalists, here are the startup founders, here are the people who go to hackathons. And then, you know, it occurred to me maybe about halfway through the research that you could really scale this. You really could look at the different spaces where the tech ecosystem forms, starting with hackathons, and as you said very well, building up to whole districts of the city where there are clusters. Eventually, by 2015 to 2017, there are clusters of tech startups and larger tech companies.
Yeah, and I think it's a really interesting way to organize it, and I think it works. I think it's because the triple helix concept and how these different players are kind of always intertwined with each other becomes like really clear when you see it happening at different scales and with, you know, at different scales. And it also lends itself to having a more like direct, almost human understanding for some of the things like the hackathon. So that's one of the things I appreciated with that chapter was, you know, there's a pretty good description of like, what is it like to be there? Like there are the stats involved, of course, with it, but also what does it feel like when you're at these events that are, you know, 24, 48 hour things and no one's sleeping and the sponsors are ordering pizza, you know, or whatever for the participants. And I think the scale factor also lends itself to that, I felt like. But so if I also remember correctly, so first of all, the things that they produce, they're not hacking anything, despite the name. Right.
They're creating, they're improving, they're working with products and devices that are provided by the sponsors of the hackathon. Mm-hmm. They're working in a space, often a co-working space, that is provided for free by the owners of the co-working space. It could be WeWork or one of WeWork's competitors, or it could be a university space. And they're just, you know, working in groups of 3, 4, 5 for the most part, not sleeping, eating pizza, you know, drinking non-alcoholic drinks. And they're really trying to create something.
There's a couple of things. The work play dynamic is something that's also embedded within this, right? Because as you had mentioned, there's from the hackers, the participants' perspective, like there are different motivations to do this, and one of them is that it's just fun. Like they love the craft, if you want to call it a craft, right? The craft of coding and software and collaborating and learning, but it's weird. Because they're doing this outside of work hours, right? This is not in their office. And because of that, there's already the sensation that it is extracurricular and borderline play. But as you said, but it's not just that, because there's someone sponsoring the event and they're hoping to get something, you know, in return, the sponsor. And that's a weird, I don't know, balance or mix. And as I was reading, I was wondering, like, I was trying to figure out, okay, who is getting the most out of the situation? You know what I mean?
Well, that's exactly what I want readers to ask. Who is getting the most out of this situation? I mean, the people who participate sometimes want to have dreams of creating their own startup one day. So they feel they're observing, you know, how companies operate. And many of these people are participating because they are improving their tech skills. They're you know, bringing up their game. Some of them are participating because it's a chance to see their friends or because they do solitary work pretty much during the workday. and this is a social event for them. It doesn't seem like so much of a social event for me because I don't write code, but it's a social event for them. And if they win, they can put this on their resume and it, you know, looks good for them. Or maybe their employer wants them to participate in hackathons. It looks good for them in their current job. While I was doing the research on hackathons, I discovered what I write about in the book. That is that Yahoo was the first company to develop hack days within the company where they would have people work at night or come outside of their cubicles to work across disciplines and you know, across teams to do the same thing, create new products for the company or improve on products or procedures that the company already had. And Yahoo discovered that this really worked and it was cheap because people would just stay after work or come on the weekends to do this. Facebook also started hackathons fairly early, like around 2000, somewhere between 2007 and 2009. And Facebook also praised hackathons for giving people the motivation and the creative space to develop new products that Facebook could then sell.
I mean, for me, I mean, everyone, I guess there's pros and cons to both sides, right? But for me, it's very parallel. And it just reminds me of my own experience working in architecture offices, let's say, where this is very similar to, you know, an intern who's going to work for one subway card a month. That's their payment. And they're doing it because they love design and they love the design that the office produces and they want to learn from the office. So you have the passion that's there, and which is then becomes like borderline play. I just love to do it. And you also have the reward of education and the resume building. And so having gone through that system, you know, in a different industry, it's like, well, at the end of it, looking back, like, I don't agree with it. You know, it's, I think, you know, I mean, obviously there's the potential as the participant to produce a great product, get hired or whatever. Yeah, there's something kind of underneath all of that that makes me very suspicious.
I think if it happens within your own company, let's say you work for an architecture office and the office is trying to do a proposal to win a project as a, you know, an RFP, an RFQ, or, you know, like you're trying to get the project and they're asking the employees, if you want to help us win the competition, stay after work and we'll brainstorm and do a design charrette for it. Right. No, I think that's fine. You're hired, you try to support the office and get exciting work, like maybe they get you pizza, like why not?
Yeah, but still.
But if you do that on your own and then the company uses what you do for them to make profit, it's a little questionable.
Yeah, so who owns the things, the products that they produce or the advancements that are made during the hackathon?
This is a shadowy area. The participants legally own their IP, their intellectual property, but it's very hard to enforce that that part of the contract. So it's difficult. But yes, there are extreme parallels between creative work and the hackathon situation for writing code. I mean, granted that writing code is creative too, but yes, and the idea is, my idea anyway, is to understand that more and more kinds of work, even well-paid work, are precarious.
Yeah, so that's the other aspect too, is the people that are participating in these things, you know, like who are they? What age group are they? How much education do they have? I assume they're working full time already, right?
And do they have to pay?
There are a lot of college students, a lot of master's students in computer science. People, people maybe who are taking courses at so-called boot camps or coding schools where you could learn how to code or you could learn how to design websites or work on user experience. People who work for financial firms doing tech work. There are all kinds of people who participate in hackathons.
Yeah, and what's fascinating, it seems like part of the characteristic of these young, I don't know, would you, technicians? They're not called technicians. Tech innovators, the coders, right?
Coders,
the people who want
engineer, engineers, actually, a lot of them are engineers, front-end engineers, back-end engineers, or app developers. There are a lot of different job categories and skill categories, but often they're called engineers.
Okay, engineers. That's what's interesting about the characteristics of these engineers, who a lot of them want to eventually, you know, create a startup, make a lot of money, sell it, and then chill out for the rest of their life. Why not? There seems to be like an equal balance between the a love for the product and the work itself, but also the entrepreneurial aspect, which is perhaps a little bit different in a way from what I've seen from a lot of creative industries. They are not as entrepreneurial or as business focused as these engineers are. So that's where this also evolves to, like, meetups and accelerators in a way, if I remember correctly, because, you know, the hackathon is just about the work and the products. It's like, it's fun, right? Let's do this. But the meetup is a much more serious thing where you're pitching something to investors more directly. And an accelerator, sort of. I mean,
but meetups are kind of ambiguous.
Okay.
The New York tech meetups, have an explicit rule. You can't talk about money. But underneath the surface, everybody who pitches a device or an app or whatever they have created is not just talking about the cool technology. They're talking about the money. They're saying, we need some money to hire more engineers, or we need some money to rent a bigger space, or, you know, we're looking for investors, but ooh, we're not talking about that.
Right.
I mean, so they're kind of an ambiguous space. Investors do go to tech meetups to see, you know, what's coming down the pike, what new products, what new smart people are coming, whom they might invest in. But the bigger venture capitalists, who are the real investment managers for tech startups, they, when they get big enough, they stop coming to meetings. People go to them and pitch to them. But the meetups are a really interesting place to see entrepreneurial tech people. Maybe a lot of people who go to hackathons are never going to have the dream of creating a startup. I think in New York City, a lot of people who participate in hackathons do actually want to create a startup. It might be different in other places, but you know, there are a lot of people like that here. And in fact, one of the hackathon winners from another country in Asia, whom we interviewed, said that it's different here from what it's like in Singapore, because in New York, the people who write code are really entrepreneurial. And that was just a college student from Singapore who said that. But yeah, the meetups are really interesting. At the time I went to several of them to observe and talk to people, there could be like 600 or 700 people coming to a monthly meetup. Those were held at an auditorium at NYU. Now they're not. Now there are far fewer people who come, not just because of the pandemic.
Okay.
And now they're virtual. But it was really interesting to see fledgling startups, and also people who had not really started a startup, talk about technology and talk about the products that they wanted to put out on the market. So yeah, there were the people who demonstrated were nearly all, not 100%, but nearly all entrepreneurial. Yeah.
The other thing is the investors who and the sponsors of these kinds of events, which might be big companies like MasterCard, for example. You know, the image that I think most people would have of that kind of person versus what you typically think of an engineer to be, which is Silicon Valley, hoodie, sweatpants, or jeans kind of deal. those seem like very different types of worlds and people. And it's throughout all of the book, there's kind of a description, it seems like, of the investor crowd wanting to, I don't want to say blend in, but they kind of dress down. They attempt to really, they definitely make an attempt to aesthetically look like they're part of this other community.
Yeah.
In the way they dress.
Many of them do. But many of them do.
Right.
As a way to like gain trust from the people they're trying to invest into?
I think so. I think they want to show they're with it. One of the startup founders.
With it.
one of the startup founders who appears in the book, who was wearing jeans and I don't remember what kind of shirt when I interviewed him. He said, yeah, he was surprised when he took meetings with venture capitalists and they turned out to wear jeans just like he was wearing. I think that they want to look as though they understand, not necessarily that they blend in, but that they understand, they know the way startup founders think, and the dress shows that. And hey, you know, it's probably just more comfortable than wearing a suit.
Yeah, that's true. So all of this starts to bleed into much larger issues and things of like the city government, how they get involved. But there was a fascinating kind of chapter that's between all of this, which is the accelerators, which is, from what I understand, basically where a startup goes if they want to accelerate their process and become a successful business. It's somewhere between like a school and a business. It seems like I'm not sure. How would you describe it?
Is it an incubator?
Well, I think
is it somewhat of an incubator in a way?
There are two stages. Incubator is the first stage, and accelerator is a second stage.
Okay.
But let me just say that somebody who wrote about startups described them as something like a factory for startups, or they could be a finishing school. I don't know if you know what a finishing school is, but back maybe in the 1950s, there used to be these kind of vocational schools for rich debutantes where they would go and learn. I don't know what they learned, but they would learn how to be society matrons in the upper class. So, and they would learn how to hold a teacup properly and how to organize a tea. Kind of like in Japan when you go to what's it called? Ikebana, a flower arranging class. So these accelerators are finishing schools for startup founders. They're also like crash business courses for startup founders. One of the startup founders whom I describe in the book, who, builds a network of dog houses that are on the street where you can rent time to put your pooch while you're inside the bodega. She said that she really learned about how to run a business from her 2 or 3 months in an accelerator. Mm-hmm. So first there is an incubator for people who just have the idea and are just founding a company. They may have raised a little money, they have a small team, so they go into an incubator. But an accelerator is a much more competitive space, and it's, you know, a 2 to 3 month intensive course for startup founders and their teams after the startups have already raised some serious money. So they compete from all over the world to get into these accelerators, which are also located all over the world. There are, you know, a large number there in New York City and also in San Francisco and, you know, places like London, where there is a large number of investors who have an increasingly deep experience in managing and advising and investing in tech startups, and a desirable cultural space for founders to come and work together. So the accelerator that I profiled in the book is called New Lab. It's located inside the Brooklyn Navy Yard, and it's owned and managed by a private real estate development company, relatively small one, who rent the space, lease the space from the Brooklyn Navy Yard, but they're heavily subsidized by the city and state governments and other various local politicos, in addition to raising private funds on their own for the space. And it's a beautiful, very well-equipped space. After I wrote the book, this accelerator, New Lab, decided that it would change its original specialization in hardware startups, that is, companies that make computer hardware, anything from drones to indoor farming equipment, and accept software startups, of which there are many, many more in New York City. And they would also accept companies that are at much earlier stages of development. So accelerators, which face an enormous amount of pressure to keep raising investment capital, keep investors involved in mentoring the companies that they accept, and competing with other accelerators to get their hands on the best companies, because the accelerators take an equity share, for the most part, in the companies that they mentor and manage and shelter and nurture, they're under some financial pressure themselves. So everybody, as I write in the book, everybody in an accelerator, from the startup founders to the accelerator managers themselves, are trying to pitch for money all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's my take on an accelerator. But they're, you know, they can be extraordinarily helpful to companies.
Sure.
And some venture capital firms, like one of the firms I also profile in the book, Union Square Ventures, they have constituted their own network of companies that they have invested in, and even though they don't have a physical accelerator for them, they try to make links between the companies to capitalize on the network effects, the social networking effects between the companies, like you would get in an accelerator. Y Combinator is the granddaddy of accelerators. It was founded in 2005 by a guy named Paul Graham, who was a graduate of Harvard. I write about him in the book. And he had the idea when he was speaking to students at Harvard who wanted to start their own tech businesses, at which he had been very successful. He had the idea that if he gathered these young people together and mentored them as a cohort, it could be a very profitable undertaking for everybody. So he sent out a call for people who wanted to start their own tech startup, and organized, you know, chose a handful of them, and organized a kind of summer school starting in Cambridge. And from the very first cohort, he had some very successful businesses. The accelerator, for the most part, takes an equity share. It could be some anywhere between 3% and 10%. If you have a government entity that is sponsoring an accelerator, often they do not take equity, or it depends on the university. But certainly the privately owned accelerators like Y Combinator or TechStars or Entrepreneurs Roundtable, they take a share of equity. But in return for their financial payout, they give intensive mentoring to the startup teams whom they select. They also put them in a network, like some venture capital firms have started to do, with a kind of virtual network of their portfolio companies, not a physical accelerator, where they, the venture capitalists, intensively give business mentoring to the companies that they have invested in, even on day-to-day operational decisions. Oh. And then they set up communications between the portfolio companies so they can take advantage of being in the same collaborative space or cultural space, even if they're not in the same physical space. Hmm. One of the startup founders whom I profile in the book, the woman who has the dog houses
dog
on
spot.
Sidewalks, where you can rent time to leave your pooch while you shop in the bodega, she learned a lot about how to run a business from her time in an accelerator in New York.
So the people who are participating in these things, the startups, are they're not having to pay to be part of the accelerator, right?
No. They don't pay. But by the same token, they really cannot work. They have to give up their day jobs if they want to be in an accelerator, because they are there, morning, noon, and night, trying to meet with people and develop their product. Right. Make the tech better. Try to keep track of any items, units that they're selling. They follow the, I want to say ideology, but they follow the business strategy of the lean startup, where you put out a product on the market when it's not altogether finished, and you kind of like grounded theory in sociology. You keep getting feedback from your customers and clients, and you keep refining the product as you go along building the business.
Is there a risk, like once you've been accepted, and you have to be accepted into a lot of these, if not all the accelerators, that's how it works.
Yeah,
is there
a
risk that you're going to get kicked out if your product is not successful?
No, I think everything builds up to the climax of pitch day at the end of your time, your cohort's time in the accelerator. And on that day, everybody, kind of like at a hackathon at the end, but with even more significance and more consequences, at an accelerator's pitch day, all of the members of the cohort pitch for 5 minutes or 10 minutes to the investors and the journalists who have come to the pitch day these days, who tune in virtually to the pitch day. And either they raise money or they don't. And if they don't raise money, they might die. Their business might die. If they raise money, then they can go on. So all of the weeks and days in an accelerator are dedicated to making a good enough pitch, and everything is targeted to that. Now, it's interesting that accelerator managers have to choose a product and a business idea, but what they are really choosing, as Paul Graham himself said at Y Combinator, is a team. Mm. If they think the team is good, then they'll even suggest to the team that they drop the idea that they came in with and pivot to another idea, which is what happens. Well, another startup founder whom I profile in the book, who sold her startup, I don't want to give it away, but anyway, she eventually sold her startup. She and her co-founders got into Y Combinator, but as soon as they got there, they pivoted to something else. And then they pivoted to a third idea.
Wow.
So you have to be flexible. I guess that's the lesson there.
Is that, I mean, I'm trying to think of any other industry that has an accelerator like.
I was just thinking that too.
I
mean, is that particular and unique to like business, or do other industry have that kind of coaching?
Because from a startup perspective, as a person who is starting their business, oh, that sounds fantastic. I mean, yeah, you're taking 3 to 10%, but I'm going to learn way more, and my chances are success are way higher than they would have been on my own.
That's right. Yeah.
And I'm like, does this exist for what we do, man? have you seen, this is a bit outside of the tech industry at this point, but have you seen other professions that have something similar, or is this the first you've come across?
Well, in a way, it's like a postdoctoral fellowship in academics, right? So, you know, you have a couple of years after you get your PhD to usually to teach part time, though, because the universities exploit everybody. But you have a couple of years to work on a book manuscript or articles, manuscripts, or do additional research while collaborating and mentoring, getting mentorship from the people who have chosen you for the postdoc.
Right. You had quoted someone saying that, or maybe you had said in the book or in here, things are getting blurred, that everyone's pitching all the time. And by everyone,
right.
That's the
accelerator, yeah.
Right. The competition aspect that seems to be, you know, interwoven into all of this is really fascinating to me. And it's interesting that these people are willing, they're okay with that being part of the game.
The game is really global capitalism, right? Mm. I mean, you know, again, there are nonprofits and government organizations that sponsor hackathons and even accelerators. But generally, the game is for the individual and the company to sell products. I mean, in the definition of innovation, to a layperson like me, maybe you, is like, oh, you create something brand new.
Sure.
But to a company, innovation means the creation of a marketable product. The marketability is built into the idea of innovation. It's not just you get a Nobel Prize,
right.
But you get a Nobel Prize because you've made this idea that feeds into a device that may save lives, but it sells a million items. You know?
Yeah.
That's the idea. It's very much a competition on all levels. The venture capitalists are in competition to raise funds too, because after all, it's not primarily their money that they're investing. It's the money of institutional investors like insurance companies or pension funds like my pension fund or a California state employee pension fund,
right.
Or Fidelity Investments. The investors in tech have got bigger and bigger over the years, and you can see that the price of buying in to a late stage startup, like Uber was a while back, or Dropbox, one of the telehealth or medical startups. Now the price is high now, and only institutional investors can afford to buy in, certainly to buy into a late stage company. Accelerators, of course, get the companies when they're at an early stage. And again, that was part of the thinking of venture capitalists. Oh, let's band together in an accelerator, put the companies together. That'll be efficient for mentoring them. And it'll also be cheaper for us to take equity now rather than later when these companies are really worth a lot of money.
And then the bigger these spaces get, also you start to bleed into who's paying for all this and what kinds of benefits are they receiving from the local government, which is a huge part of the book. And there's the Brooklyn's innovation coastline, the waterfront. But it seems like there's this elected officials need to create jobs. This is like one of the things, and also I think it looks good to have a bunch of new startups flourish and become successful in your neighborhood or in your district or in your city. And so this is where there's a lot of incentive for public officials, elected officials, to do whatever they can to get these kinds of spaces, whether it be the accelerators or entire districts, apparently, or headquarters of Amazon to be in a certain area in their district. And this starts to get a little bit, it's a peculiar relationship at that point, I feel like, because I think in the book you kind of talk about, like, so at what point is the government having to decide like who's going to be successful or guess, you know, who's going to be successful, and they're going to favor the startups and the companies or the investors who seem to have more promise over other ones? And like, how does that relate to the idea of equality?
Good question. You know, most people who talk about inequality, tech and cities focus on gentrification, but that's a major problem in San Francisco and Seattle, maybe, but not so much in New York City, because the IPOs are generally smaller for startups here. And you have so many other rich people in finance and media and celebrities and international billionaires tech is just, you know, another stream feeding into the great river of wealth going into the real estate market in New York City. What you do have here is what you mentioned, a very activist economic development agency that on the city level and also on the state level put a lot of money into tech spaces and tech training. What they do not do very consciously is, quote, pick winners and losers, end quote. Except for locational subsidies, which Amazon exemplifies in a very bad way, they don't pick specific companies. What EDC, the Economic Development Corporation of New York City, has done is to fund workspaces from accelerators and incubators to the Brooklyn Navy Yard, to the Brooklyn Army Terminal and Bush Terminal, all of which are big industrial complexes and warehouses that have pretty much become empty. EDC has fixed them up for so-called tech and creative spaces, which could be fashion designers, including fashion manufacturing, garment manufacturing, and showrooms, photography spaces, graphic arts spaces, and the Accelerator New Lab that I mentioned earlier. Also Steiner Studios has benefited from a lot of public money, including tax credits, public money in the form of tax credits, not a direct payment, but a tax credit to production companies that then rent space at the studios. So it's not usually the case that EDC picks specific companies to subsidize, but that they have funded workspaces. They've also funded the ferry lines, which are heavily subsidized because there isn't enough ridership for them to be profitable. Right. And the ferry lines, because of the peculiar locations of tech companies, the ferry lines actually function as commuting lines between various tech spaces. The locational subsidies, though, were in play for Amazon's HQ2, second North American headquarters, which they were going to build on the East River waterfront in Queens, in the area called Long Island City. And that's where the State Economic Development Corporation, which is called Empire Development, gave about $2 billion of locational subsidies to Amazon for this headquarters. The city kicked in about $1 million also, so there was a pretty hefty $3 billion package there on a space that otherwise would have been used for possibly biotech development and some community facilities. The locational subsidies that the city was going to give were REAP, REAP subsidies, for locating a business or relocating a business to any borough outside of Manhattan. These were all city and state considered as of right subsidies. They were not specially designed for Amazon, but they were specially packaged and offered to Amazon. So these REAP subsidies are also given to tech startups. If a startup, let's say, starts in Manhattan and wants to relocate to even a very popular area on the waterfront in Brooklyn, like Williamsburg or the Brooklyn Navy Yard, they can get these locational subsidies. Or if they start out in Brooklyn or Queens or Staten Island or the Bronx, they can get these REAP, R-E-A-P, locational subsidies from the city government and, you know, whatever else they might get from the Small Business Administration of the federal government and the Empire Development Corporation of the state government. So the subsidies are like for places, they're place-based, but individual companies get them, and they get them in return for promising to create specific numbers of jobs
right.
that will last for a certain time.
Right. The whole Amazon HQ2 fiasco or event or whatever you call it is like really interesting for many reasons. But one of them, of course, is that you have a private company. I mean, they're not just some private company, it's Amazon, but a private company has basically, you know, at that time said to all these cities, you tell us why we should come to your city. And the reasons why we should come to your city is, sure, there's kind of maybe the cultural, historical aspects, or maybe one city is more entrepreneurial in its DNA than another, but also what kind of breaks are we going to get, right? And it's so, in some ways, it would feel almost backwards that that would be the case, that, you know, government officials are having to feel like they have to or elect to bend over backwards to appeal to this private company. And I'm not going to give everything away, but of course, how things evolved and the number of jobs promised versus what it would actually end up being was different, and, you know, pretty astonishing things. And that's the other aspect we were wondering is the creation of jobs. You hear this all the time for and across many different industries, but in particular for the tech industry, like what kind of jobs are we talking about? Because typically, I feel like when people think about we're creating new jobs, you first think about those who are probably, you know, don't have a four-year degree from UCLA or from NYU. You know, they're people that need the jobs on the lower class, monetary scale. But the jobs that are going to be brought by these kinds of spaces, you know, tech spaces, are they benefiting the people who need it the most? Or are they benefiting kids who, yes, they have student loans, but also have, you know, 4 or 6 years of education and are already, you know, working at Google, so to speak?
Good question. Let me just say for everyone's amusement that the gossip is that Jeff Bezos was jealous of the Tesla company for getting big subsidies to locate a plant in Nevada. And that's what put it in Amazon's mind to create this big competition to see which local government could offer them the biggest subsidies. And by the way, they also got a very large amount of data that the local governments collected about the workforce, transportation infrastructure, and development plans within those 238 communities. So the competition as a whole may have started with the little green bird of jealousy in Jeff Bezos' mind looking at Elon Musk and the state of Nevada, but it turned into a very interesting yield for Amazon. But yeah, the jobs in tech. Our progressive city government, self-declared progressive city government under Mayor de Blasio, thought that they could have their cake and eat it too. They could have this very high status, rich star in the ecosystem, Amazon, which would enhance the reputation of New York to other tech companies. But they would also have a large number of different kinds of jobs. Because jobs using digital technology, I'm saying using digital technology, are all kinds of jobs. I mean, you could say that my job, typing my book manuscript in Word, is a tech job because I use digital technology. An interesting survey that was done in New York's business community a few years ago showed that half of the jobs using digital technology are not in tech companies, and a large number of jobs in the tech economy do not require a college degree. I mean, you could parse that any way you want and ask exactly how much education those job holders have and what they do. But the cake and eat it too philosophy says we can subsidize a major tech corporation, but they will create a lot of jobs for people on lower skill levels. Not everybody who works for Amazon or Google is a an AI engineer, but you know, there are a lot of lower skill jobs. The interesting thing is that other surveys in New York show that the people who hold the lower skilled tech jobs are not only the less educated part of the workforce, but they are also the ethnic and racial minority part of the workforce. So you have more people of African-American, Black backgrounds, and Hispanic, Latino backgrounds in the lower echelons of the tech workforce. And you have the European white and East Asian, South Asian background people in the higher echelons. Mm-hmm. They are typically the people with PhDs and master's degrees and more prestigious college degrees in computer sciences, data science. So there is an extreme stratification within the tech industry.
Right.
Women are found among the more highly educated echelons and also the lower educated part of the tech workforce. I mean, so, you know, in my book on the innovation complex, I bring in our popular term meritocracy and subject that to some a strenuous going through, because the tech workforce is indeed stratified, where you have the people in, you know, the AI engineers, the people who earn $250,000 a year at the very top. And some of them, a very small number of them, but some of them may actually have risen from working class backgrounds through their hard work and acquisition of very good skills. But very few of them do come from that background. Then there are the people who are contract workers, even within Google, whose jobs are insecure and whose salaries are less, but they may have engineering degrees. You know, I've seen data that show that half of Google employees are contract employees, even engineers. I don't know how that breaks down in New York, where Google has a lot of engineers, but they also have a lot of advertising and marketing personnel who undoubtedly earn lower salaries than artificial intelligence engineers and data scientists. So the tech workforce is not all, you know, not all people earning huge amounts of money, and not all people with stock options.
Right.
In these days of pandemic, they might not be exercising those stock options either. And then we have the people whom the New York City government has in their heart of hearts, the people who are not college graduates, who've never been to college, who can go through an intensive coding school experience and after 3 months come out with enough knowledge, enough skill, after enough hard work and sleepless nights to get a job that might pay $65,000 to $85,000 a year, where previously they might only have been able to earn $20,000 a year.
Right.
So, you know, the city government was thinking about upward social mobility, but maybe not upward social mobility to the very highest levels of the tech workforce.
is there a sense of what percentage of the jobs that are going to be offered are for people who have to have either a fair amount of education already, or they have to go through one of these for-profit schools that you're kind of talking about? Like, what percentage of the jobs are kind of for those people versus jobs that someone on the lower income scale can get, like, off the bat? Because that's, I feel like a lot of these neighborhoods, I don't know about now, actually it's changed so much, but a lot of people that are living there are, they don't have those kinds of, they don't have the education or training. So it's like, you know, we're going to get this new facility or this new district or whatever. But for a lot of people that are there already, doesn't really help them if the vast majority of those jobs require training that they just don't have.
So the thing is that in addition to funding training schools for people to learn how to write computer code, the Economic Development Corporation and the Brooklyn Navy Yard fund job training facilities for people who are manufacturing workers to improve their skills so they can work with computer-aided manufacturing. Those jobs are never going to be able to employ the vast numbers of people who need those jobs. Okay. So there is a job skills mismatch in all the cities where tech is growing, which is basically every place, mm-hmm. especially in the so-called superstar cities like New York and San Francisco. Even if the city governments, as in New York and San Francisco, have a commitment to maintaining manufacturing, the competitive factors in the city's political economy dictate that the white-collar jobs and the professional jobs and the engineering jobs are going to have more political impact than the manufacturing jobs. So at the Brooklyn Navy Yard, they have a big job training facility that has worked with residents of nearby public housing projects, people who are already employed in factory jobs at the Brooklyn Navy Yard, and worked with formerly incarcerated men and women to enable them to apply for tech jobs and to offer them internships. When it comes to getting paying jobs, I think the Navy Yard, like other sponsors of job training facilities, cannot really guarantee that, but they can try to make the participants in their schools as job ready and competitive as they can be.
Right.
The Brooklyn Navy Yard is also the site of a new STEM, or STEAM, I should say, new STEAM, science, technology, engineering, arts, and math high school, where young people from Brooklyn neighborhoods can go to the high school and work in internships with employers at the yard, which is really, you know, really tremendous. Whether there are students who want a more traditional vocational training, or they're students who want to be engineers. So a lot of training is necessary. I mean, the coding schools, aka boot camps, because of the intensity of the preparation, they say, oh yeah, you know, come to us. Even if you're a poet or a dreamer, you can learn how to code. I don't know if I could learn how to code. I don't think everybody can really learn how to code. And as I write in the book from my interviews with people who manage these coding schools, the competition to be accepted to a coding school is pretty intense already. You have to teach yourself how to code, at least according to the rudimentary lessons, to create a coding sample before you are accepted to a coding program. And EDC, the New York City government, has given a lot of support to coding boot camps and fellowships two students who have never been to college to learn how to code, but you have to demonstrate that you have that aptitude and that you have that motivation to stay up all night to write something before you're accepted into these programs.
And these programs are most often, they're private organizations, right?
They're public and private. One of the interesting initiatives that I write about in the book, which will be a monument to Mayor de Blasio's progressive administration, the way Cornell Tech is a monument to former Mayor Bloomberg's more elitist administration, is that there is going to be a centrally located, multi-story facility where nonprofit organizations will teach coding courses and other kinds of courses to help low-income people become job-ready for work in tech companies.
It's interesting because on the one hand, the narrative sounds like beautiful and convincing and great because, you know, this feels like a story we've heard like many times before. If, you know, technology advances and as a result, jobs disappear, right? The manual labor jobs disappear. I always think of the auto industry for some reason.
So how do
you deal with the problem? Well, you can always, there's always a certain amount of jobs that you know, have to be filled that require low levels of skill. But as you pointed out, that's not a lot most often, right? So then the other option is to train people to be able to do the more advanced jobs that require more skill. And, you know, the government and these for-profit boot camps and things, that sounds like really great. But also, so I can understand that from a perspective of a person who's in a citizen who's in that situation, they want to get a higher paying job of 70 to 80 grand, which from an architectural background, yeah, that sounds pretty good to me. you know, that sounds great, but... And so I understand that, but at the same time, there seems to be some kind of weird, almost conflict of interest of what the education system or the academy, the academic institutions are supposed to be more concerned with. Maybe this is a little more philosophical or conceptual, more concerned with rather than them being worried about what the existing employers want. Like how do you approach the problem of education? And on one hand, you could say, okay, we just need to get people, train them so they know how to do this job and we know what training they need because I've talked to all of the businesses that are happening. So this is what we're going to teach you and we guarantee you make this amount of money. That's one kind of direction to approach it, but that's very different from saying we have beliefs as an education system, as an institution, and we're going to teach you this way and we're not going to be driven. Their curriculum is not going to be driven by what employers want, but rather some other set of principles, ideas, or something.
Well, then, and also...
Guess what?
Yeah.
Guess what? In the real world, everybody needs a job. And colleges like these for-profit coding boot camps, they know that their students want to get jobs when they graduate. They need to get jobs when they graduate. So... universities and for-profit schools have tried to get into the pipeline where they know what employers want when employers want it. I mean, one of the big issues with university-trained computer scientists, that is, you know, young people or not, whatever people who graduate with computer science degrees, is that they may have learned some great theories, but they might not be down with the latest programming language.
Right.
So whether it's the Ivy Tower, the Ivy League, or some for-profit coding boot camp, they need to be directly in communication with employers to know what skills employers want. And the de Blasio administration has put a lot of money into a program. Again, it's one of those triple helix tripartite partnerships where companies loan some of their employees to to teach at CUNY, City University of New York colleges. It's still a limited program now, but they teach at the colleges the latest skills that their employer wants right now. They don't have enough time, though, and the companies will not spare them for enough time for these people to do real full-scale teaching work on grading papers and you know, tutorials. So graduate assistants grade the papers and teach the discussion sections while the people from the companies come in and teach the skills. The Tech Talent Pipeline, which is the umbrella initiative from the city government that is running this kind of program, also has worked with companies to set up internships, which CUNY students, you know, who don't have personal connections and with tech companies, they really need these, as does, you know, as do many students. So the thinking is all around that students need to be brought close to employers.
Is there a point at which the balance tips too far in that direction?
Sure. I mean, you know, on the one hand, employers, maybe the more prestigious employers like Google, Microsoft, they want engineers who have technical skills, but they also have the deep knowledge in, you know, I forget what it's called, like, you know, knowledge bases, where they can be data scientists. Apparently, you cannot get that from an intensive 12-week course. You really have to get it from a college education, maybe graduate, postgraduate education. So there will always be a need for more broader training, whether it is broader training in tech or generalist training, which most companies say they prefer their job applicants to have. There is something in me, though, as someone who has a liberal arts education and a PhD in a social science, that says, let's not give up on a liberal arts education. Yeah. You know, let's keep the employers at arm's length from determining what we teach in our courses. By the same token, I know that sociology graduates would like to be assured of a job or a paying internship, at least, when they graduate from college. So there's a real dilemma here, you know, and you know, a country like Germany has had historically a very strong apprenticeship program for manual workers who graduate from vocational schools or Hochschule and they go into industrial jobs. So, you know, there has to be a balance between a liberal arts philosophical education, a vocational education, and satisfying the needs of specific employers at the employer's demand. You know, it's a little bit like hackathons where you really have to try to establish arm's length between the sponsors of hackathons, or here the teachers who are brought in to teach tech skills to university students or boot camp students, and the minds, the brains of the students themselves. I think that the situation in tech in 2019 and 2020 is only exacerbated now with the coronavirus pandemic. Hmm. Big tech is going to thrive even more. Yeah. You know, the 4, 5, 6 big companies in the U.S. and China and elsewhere, they are going to do very well. But the future independent startups, the small companies that have good ideas, I don't know that there will be room for them. And I think that is really going to kill innovation in many ways.
So I did have a question on that, because to play devil's advocate, there's the question of, like I think you wrote in the book, that this is a new iteration of capitalism, or that the innovation complex is, you know, this era's capitalism. And there are negatives to that, as we've kind of discussed. But isn't it, wouldn't it be the case that because it's an innovation focused industry, that therefore there's the opportunity for it to be more productive and more good, because it's not, I don't, I'm trying to figure out how to describe this, because innovation is the thing that we're investing in, and innovation in itself is good. Does that make sense? Like, we're guaranteeing in a way that progress for the better is going to happen, because that's what we're investing in. And innovation is not a finite determined product, but it's a, I don't know, a mode of thinking almost.
But the powerful players determine which innovation will move forward and which will turn into products and devices for whose interest, for whose purposes.
Yep.
that's about it. I think we might just, I know we're out of time, but I think we might spend 2 seconds saying that I'm nostalgic for the commercial real estate market that Tech and Creative Offices was part of, a very speculative part of, that I criticize in the book. But the innovation complex is not only a psychoanalytic concept that has to do with the power of the tech industry, and the fear that that inspires, but it also has to do with the material architecture and design of areas of the city and specific offices in areas of the city. So the pandemic has everybody in the tech industry just about working remotely, and many people in the tech industry saying, yeah, great, more remote work, more products that depend on the cloud, more apps and platforms and so on. So without going into the really life-threatening conditions of the gig economy workers who deliver products ordered through tech platforms, this is a really serious question. What's going to happen to vast areas of cities that are now office buildings? Are people ever, going to populate them, or should we all turn them into affordable housing? We don't know.
Ah, that wouldn't be the worst thing.
that would be the bright side,
right? Absolutely. Well, look, if you have a few minutes, I did want to ask you, because you teach at CUNY and part of that system, obviously, and just a few weeks ago, I think it has been now, obviously Michael Sorkin had passed away because of COVID-19. And he also was part of the CUNY system.
Well, Michael was not only my CUNY colleague, but a dear friend. Of course, he had thousands of dear friends all over the world, and it has been a source of both comfort and discomfort to me that all of us join around the world, at least online, to grieve him. He was, in the words every one of his friends are using, he was a public intellectual. He was a generous teacher and generous friend. He always had time for everyone. Well, you were his student. I don't know how he was as a teacher to you, but he instructed us by his writing, by his conversation, by the example of what he did. And in many ways, he was the most innocent of persons. A world traveler without the pretensions of sophistication or sophistry. He was, just a really wonderful person who had time for everyone, and try to organize everyone and enlist them in the cause of democracy and fighting for a more equal city. So, he was just a tremendous person. I was supposed to have dinner with him, but the coronavirus closed down the restaurant, and then it closed down all the restaurants. So, I last saw him in his office. He was physically frail. He was not in the best of health, But his spirit was as strong as ever, and he was undertaking, you know, more books for Terraform's publishing arm, UR, and he was, upset that he had to postpone more trips and couldn't meet with as many people as he always met with. But his door and his heart were always open.
That is beautifully said, and that is an accurate description of how I remember him inside and outside of the studio. Well, Sharon, this has been fantastic. The book is amazing. Everyone, you should check it out. We'll put up links and things like this. And as of, because of the pandemic, you have to order it via the Kindle version for now, right?
Yes, sorry. Yeah. Sorry, Amazon, yeah. Thank you very much. Let's stay in touch. I really treasure our first meeting and our continuing to be in touch. Thank you so much. I look forward to seeing what you make of this.
Great. Thanks, Sharon.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone, for listening to this week's episode of The Midnight Charrette. And shout out to our guest, Sharon, for joining us via the magic of Zoom from New York City to California. Love the conversation as usual. And we're glad that she is doing well and safe during these troubled times. The Innovation Complex, is available on Amazon and as in a Kindle version for the moment. We recommend it. We also appreciate that you're listening. If you want to support this show and you like what we're doing, then leave us a review on iTunes. We're on iTunes, Spotify, and YouTube, but iTunes is the place to leave reviews. That's how it goes.
Yeah.
Right, we're also on all of the social medias. We're everywhere. So reach out to us if you have questions, comments, or, well, those are the only two things you can really have. You can hit us up through our hotline, right?
Yep.
Which is 213-222-6950. Call or text the hotline. If you call, it goes straight to voicemail. We play the voicemail on the show. We have a conversation about whatever it is you're saying. And if you text, we'll do the same thing, right? Anything else?
I think you did it all. I could retire now.
All right, me too. I'm constantly. All right, everybody. Thanks again for listening. I will talk to you again next week. Bye.
Stay safe. Bye-bye.